not but joyful, but most days joyful. We love them just like they're our own children. And just like the little bird, we're ready to let them fly out of the nest now. We do have a few that are not seated over here. Sue Ann DeBus is our photographer, the stills, and Bert Barr in the back. I also want to say happy birthday, Phyllis Applebaum, today.
High school. And I mean, you should see this thing. Sleeves came to here. chest. I was going to grow into this thing. And believe me, I had it all that time, too. Anyway, graduation night, I had this girlfriend named Patricia Babbler. She was in the same graduating class. And afterwards, we were going to have, see, we graduated in the hall there at school. And afterwards, we were going to have a dance. And of course, she was going to be my girl at the dance, but we were going out. And so, I had like zero money, right? But my mother advanced me $3 on my allowance so that I could buy her a wrist corsage, because that's what she said she wanted. So I show up that night in my dorky suit, carrying this wrist corsage for Pat Ballard. None of the other guys had bought corsages for their girlfriends. I mean, and I had to stand around and hold this thing, and her parents hated me. I mean, totally hated me. And so I was going to have to give this to her somewhere or another. I ended up holding it through the whole graduation ceremony, put it on my chair. All the guys were riveted about this big old. It was three white carnations on a wrist corsage. But then afterwards, she put it on, and I felt kind of good about that. The dance was neat and everything. I understand y'all don't have a dance after this, do you? So it's punching cookies with the parents, huh? Hey, that's the breaks. I'm going to tell you. I know that y'all probably aren't dating yet, but I want to tell you a story about Susie's first date, because it illustrates something, has a moral to it. It's a sort of parable, and it will become apparent to you at the end of the story. Susie's first date, her mother says, now look, Susie, you're going out on your first date tonight, for y'all, this is going to be sometime next year or the year after. And I know exactly how it's going to go, so I want to tell you all about what's going to happen tonight, because I'm kind of worried, and I don't want to worry about this date. And you told Johnny to come pick you up at 7 o'clock, but when 7 o'clock comes and Johnny arrives, you won't be ready. So he'll come into the living room, he'll sit down with me, we'll have a nice conversation, he'll be on his best behavior, he'll be very manly, he won't fidget, he'll talk to me until about 7:30 when you do get ready, and when you come into the living room, he's going to say, oh, Susie, what a beautiful dress you're wearing, and how lovely you look tonight. Then when you leave, he's going to open the car door for you, close it behind you, he's going to take you to the dance, he's going to dance every dance with you, he's not going to pay attention to any of the other girls at all, not look at any of them, and be a perfect gentleman and make you feel very happy. Afterwards, he's going to take you to eat, and he'll use the correct fork for his salad, the correct fork for his main meal, the correct spoon for his soup, the correct fork for his dessert. He'll put the napkin on his lap. He'll hold the chair for you. I mean, it's going to be just perfect. He won't eat like he normally does at home. Then afterwards, y'all are going to get back in the car. He's going to open the door for you, close the door, start the car, and drive you straight to Lover's Lane. He's going to shut off the ignition and begin to slide his arm around your shoulder. And that, Susie, is when your mother is going to begin to worry. Please don't make me worry tonight. Susie says, not to worry, Mother. Don't worry about it then. 7 o'clock comes sharp. Johnny shows up. Susie's not ready. He goes to the living room and has polite conversation with Mom till 7:30. And Susie does get ready, walks into the living room. He says, oh, Susie, what a beautiful dress you're wearing. And how lovely you look tonight. Mom's going. He walks her out to the car, opens the door for her. She gets in the car, they drive to the dance, he dances every dance with Susie, doesn't pay attention to any of the girls, doesn't look at them, totally ignores everybody except Susie. Susie feels very special. Afterwards, he takes her to eat, he uses the correct fork for his salad, correct fork for his main course, correct, you know, everything's great, he uses a napkin, he doesn't eat like he normally does at home. After that's over, they get in the car, Susie starts to wonder, he starts the car and he drives straight to Lover's Lane. Shuts off the ignition and begins to slide his arm around her shoulder. She knocks his arm out of the way, jumps in his lap, puts both her arms around his neck and says, oh no, you know, tonight your mother's going to worry. Some of the things that Mrs. Bryan didn't tell you about that I do right now in my life are that, one, I work with kids who are at risk of dropping out of high school, and I talk to thousands of them all over the Houston area and different parts of Texas every year, and I talk to their teachers as well about keeping them in school and how to motivate kids not to drop out and how to stay in school. The reason I do that is because although I've been a really good student up to 8th grade, I kind of fell in with the wrong crowd in high school, and the net result was that in March of my senior year, I was expelled and never graduated from high school. Later, I took the GED test and got into college and graduated on the dean's list with some things, because of some things that I had learned in the intervening years between when I was expelled from high school and when I went to college. Those were crucial years for me. There were three of them, and they were spent in the United States Marine Corps. 13 months of that in Vietnam, in combat. Also worked with kids at Covenant House, Texas, which is an emergency shelter for runaway and throwaway youth. These are kids 10 to 17 years old who have either run away from home or who, you know, sometimes we have the parents drive up and drop the kid off. Take this kid, I don't want him or her anymore. That Covenant House is set up to keep 80 kids a night. We've been running 118, 125 since January. 90% of these kids are from right here in Houston, Texas. And I work with them and have a special interest for those kids because that same thing happened to me. Because in March of my senior year of high school, when I was expelled, back a few months earlier in November of the year before, my dad had finally had enough of me and invited me to leave. And so I had a job at a movie theater in San Antonio making The Munificent Sum of 75 cents an hour, which translated into about $32 a week. And I spent $10 a week of that money living in the YMCA in downtown San Antonio. It was no one was greatly surprised when a few months later I was expelled from school. I had somehow gone wrong after 8th grade. I had a lot to do with running wrong with the wrong group. Thank God there were no drugs at that time, or none that we could find. I mean, the most trouble we could get into was an occasionally pilfered bottle of Lone Star beer. I mean, there was no marijuana, no cocaine, no crack, none of that stuff. Because I think that then, if there had been, there had been a lot more kids as conflicted and as trouble, in as much trouble as I was. But what happened was that when I was in the Marines, when I got off the bus at the Marine Corps Recruit Depot in San Diego, California, there was this wonderful guy standing there. He was wearing this crisp green outfit, spit-shine boots, and a Smokey the Bear hat, and his name was Sergeant Frank Brown. He was a Marine Corps drill instructor. And the moment that he saw me, he took a very special interest in me. These guys are masters of psychology. It might have been that when I got off the bus there, I was bald. I had shaved my head to make some sort of statement. I'm not quite sure what the statement was, but I had done that, and the moment he saw me, it was like somebody had written him a 10-page letter about my life. And this guy, for the next 3 months, had the generosity and the kindness to devote every waking hour of his to my development. And he had very persuasive means of doing this. Anyway, he showed me just how much of a punk I was, beat me down to nothing, and built me back up in 3 months as a Marine. Graduated from boot camp as the guidon bearer, which means nothing to you except that I got to carry the flag of my platoon, and I was given a promotion to private first class. And it was the first real achievement, aside from my graduation in 8th grade, that I could really put my hands on. I went to sniper school in North Carolina, and then I was sent to Vietnam. I won't even try to explain to you what war is like, but suffice it to say that anything you can imagine is somewhat better by comparison. And it began to dawn on me during this time that the guys I run around with, the things I had done, the things I considered important, the agenda I had set up for myself was really not valid. It began to occur to me that if and when I survived this war and got out of the Marine Corps without a high school diploma, I would amount to nothing. So I took a couple of mentors while I was in Vietnam. One of them was Gunnery Sergeant White. Sound familiar, Elise? I don't think there's any, where's Elise? There you are. I don't think there's any relationship, but anyway, Gunnery Sergeant White was one of them, and he told me some things that I'd like to share with you. I can't, unfortunately, share these things with you in the exact same language that Gunny White used, but here's the gist of them. He said, you know, in a free enterprise system, like we have in America, and the value for which we are over here fighting, in a free enterprise system, you're rewarded by what you produce, and that's all. When you were in school and you messed that up, what you did was you messed up the job you had in life. Because when you're, he said, what kind of car are you going to get when you get back home? And I said, well, I want to buy a GTO. Anybody know what that is? Your parents did. He said, well, you know, when you were in school, you didn't have the money, so nobody could fault you for not having a GTO. But you weren't paid money in school, but it was your job and you were paid in grades. You know, like an A, for example, might be a GTO. A B might be a Ford. A C might be a used Chevy. A D is like the bus. And an F is like walking, right? And if you drive A's in school long enough, then you don't have to come over here and fight a war and be paid $100 a month and save it up to buy a car later. I mean, things can be a lot easier. School is what it's about. So when I was about to get out of the Marine Corps, I took the GED test, studied for it, took it, passed it, took the SAT test and got into college, and I turned my life around. And then I graduated on the Dean's List and made it, and much to my great surprise, I had the ability to do this, and I learned that almost everyone does. At this point, I'd like, if you don't mind, Elise, if you'd come up here for just a second, because I'd like to help, for Elise to help me share and demonstrate with you just how this is done. Elise is going, oh, why me? Why? Elise, thank you. Let me ask you this. Elise, since fourth grade, you've been making like 4.0 of all A's, right? Okay. Well, could you, when you were doing this, could you like walk into a classroom, right? Never open the book and still make an A in the course?
Yes.
You mean to tell me, like, you could go into a classroom, never open the book, not even know what was in it? Never pay attention to the teacher and still. We're going to change our minds a little bit on this, huh? Okay. Well, it's a lot easier if you open the book, follow along with the teacher to learn the material, correct?
Yeah.
And if you go home at night and you don't do your homework and you come back to the next school, to the next day of that class, can you make an A?
No.
If you go home at night and you know you have a test the next day and you don't study for it, can you make an A? Chance. Elise, you're really helping me out a lot. Elise, are you a natural born genius? No. Actually, you do kind of have to pay attention, follow along with the teacher, study for the test, etc., to do well, make an A.
Right.
Well, let me ask you this, Elise. Why did you go to all that trouble?
Easier.
Either easier than what? Than not doing it? Well, did it ever occur to you that, I don't know, maybe somewhere in the back of your mind? Did you ever think, gee, if I do well in school, I might get a good job sometime? And what happens when you get a good job? More money. Police? There's $20. Thank you very much.
Here and now, that you're going to get it by work.
Now, a lot of people say to me, Bill, man, I've been making C's and D's forever. How am I going to get the habit of making A's? It's not possible. It'll never happen. And that's simply not true. Because if I can do it, anybody can do it. Can you put your hands together like this for me for a second? Ollie, I invite everybody to do this. Now look, some of you have your right thumb over your left. Some of you have your left thumb over your right. If you have your right thumb over your left, raise your hands. Okay? Put them down. Now you have it the other way, raise your hand. Now look around. It's 50-50. Exactly about, statistically, about half the population does it this way and half does it this way. So what's the big difference? What makes us so different? Why do some people do it one way and one the other? Pressure into this. Some of you will have your right hand showing, some will have your left hand. If you have your right hand showing, raise your hand. Put it down. If you had it the other way, raise your hand. Look around. It's 50-50. Why do some people do like this and some do like this? By the way, if you did it like this, try and do it the other way. Follow the other way. See how normal and natural and comfortable that feels? If you had your right thumb over your left, do it the other way. See how nice and normal and comfortable that feels. Well, look, here's the point of this little exercise. The people who study behavioral science tell us that if you had your right over your left or your left over your right, and you want to change, all you have to do is do it 3 times a day for 3 weeks. 3 times a day for 3 weeks in the new way. At the end of that time, it'll feel weird to do it the way you used to do it. And that's just the way it is. Same thing with crossing your arms. And almost any other behavioral pattern that you have. Almost any other one. You see, you can change your habit. And what I invite students to do, and this doesn't apply to you necessarily because I know you've come to a great school with great teachers and you've done well in school, and from every outward sign of evidence, you're going to do well in high school and college. But what I invite kids to do is to, okay, if you're not in the habit of opening the book and paying attention and following along with the teacher during class, just do it. 3 classes a day for 3 weeks. Automatically, some things are going to happen. One, you're going to start making a better grade. Two, the teacher's going to start wondering, what's up with Johnny? And three, if you try to go back to the old way, it's going to be uncomfortable. So you get yourself in a pattern, in a new habit, in a new way of doing things. And then the old, unwinning, unsuccessful way seems foreign and hard to do. Seems foreign and hard to do. Then you break yourself into a winning pattern. And anybody can do this. Let me tell you something about teachers. Y'all are lucky because you've already figured this out. One kid raised his hand one time and said, hey look, this stuff you're talking about A's, my English teacher, Mrs. Smith, she made A's, brags about making A's when she was in high school and college. Man, you ought to see the piece of junk she drives. Well, here's what I tell them, and it's absolutely true. Teachers aren't like regular people. They are strange.
Nobody appreciates them and they keep doing it anyway.
And if you ask your teacher for help, what do they say? No, get out of here, I'm going to help you. Never. Okay, what do you need? And wherever you go to high school, it's going to be just like that. I can't promise you to be that way in college, because by and large, you're supposed to have picked up these skills by then on your own. But in high school, it'll be that way too. You see, if you get yourself in the habit of succeeding in class and doing well, and you're having a little bit of trouble getting over the hump from the B to the A, the teacher will help you. Wants to do it. Is getting paid to do it. Not very well, not very much. But they actually want to. They want to see all their students do well and succeed. It's their whole thing. That's what they're about. And that's what makes them not like regular people. They want to help you succeed. It can be done. You can all be driving Ferraris. Do you want to? Guy says, no, I'm a Lamborghini. It's cool. You can have one of those too. It'll work. You're probably thinking, I don't know, 8th grade. What are we, 13? 13? 14? No big deal. But you know what the big deal about it is and why I love to talk to people who are 7th and 8th grade, just going into high school? Because right now, the blackboard of your life is clean as a whistle. There's not a thing written on it. No matter what has gone on in terms of your academic achievement in this school or anywhere else you were before, wherever you go to high school now, to Strait, to St. Agnes, to Bel Air, wherever you go, when you walk in there, the blackboard of your academic achievement life is wiped clean. From the first day you arrive there, you start to write on that blackboard. And that is where your life is really going to begin. From the standpoint of what you become one day. Your blackboard's clean. This is a moment that you should cherish, because it's the last moment it'll ever be like that. Because whatever you do, from the first day you go into high school, till the day you get out of college, is going to be written on that blackboard and you won't be able to erase it. It's going to be there. You see what a wonderful opportunity you have? There's nothing on the blackboard of your life. It's clean. You can start writing A's on that bad boy in September. And you can do it all the way through high school. I have a daughter who just graduated from St. Agnes on Saturday. She had gone to Holy Ghost before. She'd done real well with the Holy Ghost. When she got to St. Agnes, she met this boy named Matthias. Gone to study with him for 4 years. Now she's going out to St. Mary's University in San Antonio, and he's going to the University of Texas. Heidi is her name. And Heidi always made good grades in high school as well. But she didn't make straight A's, because that was her decision not to do it, I guess. But she had the same information that you have. And I think what sometimes happens with girls, and I don't want to unfairly characterize Heidi or anybody else with this, but I think sometimes the girls think, it's not really that important. I'm a girl. I'm not going to be a doctor. I'm not going to be a lawyer. I'm not going to strive to succeed because I'm going to marry somebody who's going to do this. Well, let me tell you, that is the worst thing that a young lady can do in terms of her life right now, to count on someone else, the worst. Listen, these guys that you're graduating with tonight are not more than 50% of the world. You're the other half. And in my business, and in a lot of them that I see, women are beginning to take the forefront in all these industries. And you have to be ready for it. So just get ready for that. When you get out in that world, you're going to be working. The statistics say you're going to. Look at your moms. Most of them are working. And if you want to do well, if you want to succeed, and you want to be happy, you have to start in with this clean blackboard, just like the guys do. come this far. Some of you, like Elise, have done very well. Some of you haven't done quite that well, but you all have the opportunity to do anything you want. Anything you want. It's all fresh in you once you go to high school. Embrace that thought. Do well. Succeed. Be happy. Have a great life. God bless you.
board member.
David Cox. Amanda.
Mary Simon.
Brett Triola. Elise White. Rachel Sabatsky would like to come up.
catching people pigging out, aren't you? I'm going back for my squat, so you can catch me.
Thank you. You don't be stripping my mom.
Did you tell him? No, quit. Fire show. Quit. This is...
No. Are you filming us?
No, see the lights not blinking. Well, that's where people are. What? Don't touch me. I'm streaming you. You'll spill something else on me. Spill hot coffee all over me.